This is our studio. We are just behind. This is the opera, and over here behind that, we have the architect school in Copenhagen. So we are close to the architect school and close to the studio. This is an old area where there used to be the Navy, and they used to build small boats in these sheds here. And we moved in there just a year ago now. So this is the inside of it. 2,000 square meters, one open space. Here we can practice what I really believe in. We can have knowledge sharing, we can have interaction between all the people that work in there and learn from each other, and we can have all our stuff in there, most of all our models and things. And here we have the office. That's when we, that's how we look when we win a competition, which we luckily do from time to time, of course. We are about 90 people, a little bit more than 90 people in the place, and here we we can exhibit to our models, and we can build our models. We have a model shop too. I'll come back to that. This is the competition team. At all times, we make at least four competitions parallel, because we live primarily from competitions. This is I'm sitting just here, so I don't have my own office too. I believe in that it's very important to sit amongst everybody that work with and learn from them and collaborate, and they can always come to me and I come to them. I don't sit very much. I walk around all the time to talk and to teach, actually, too. And this is our research department, GXN. That's in the center of the office, where we are where we're investigating new materials, new technologies, and doing a lot of weird things. This is actually an entity that is giving profit to. We are researching, but we're getting funding from the state, from EU, and from private funding funds as well. And we have developed, actually invented things, even that we never thought we were going to invent anything. But we have invented some new materials as well. So this is, they're sitting here in the middle, and we have this beautiful view out to the water, so you couldn't have it any better, I think. This is a little exhibition they have with new materials that they have developed. And here we have the model shop, and that's actually a very important part, I think, of the office. Everybody today design on computers, and everybody can do 3D, of course, on computers. But then, if you don't do these models, you lose the texture and the sense and the feeling of what you're doing. So we build a lot of models, big models, small models, and all these concept models here that we built, 20, 30, 40 models every time we in a competition to test things. And we do that with laser cutters and blade cutters. Not so much in printers. We do print models too, but that's more when we know where we're going, actually. I think this is about the layering of a building that you have cut out in a laser cutter or blade cutter is very good, because if you can build it like this, you can build it in reality too. That's why we do it this way here too. A little bit about the models here. You can see that they are here and there and everywhere. So when we moved from the other place where we were before, when we were sitting in two stories and we couldn't have all the models, we had them stored. Here we can look at the models every day and be inspired by what we have done ourselves. What inspires me, by the way, is nature. I think when you see something like this, this is created in nature, and it could be a building, and it also has everything here has a function, and it's still so beautiful. You cannot imagine anything more beautiful. So I think this is the greatest inspiration you can get, and it's the greatest inspiration for form in the way that we are working. All this and for some, this is a meat-eating plant, a dangerous thing, but it's a beautiful thing at the same time. It's try to attract flies and whatever into here, and then it can eat it afterwards. But anyway, it is a beautiful form, and these forms, I think, is a great inspiration to how we try to develop our architecture in the future as well. There's another thing that's a big. Yeah, what we call inspiration for me is about, or a sentence we always use, is how architecture shapes behavior. We had an exhibition 5 years ago called Mind Your Behavior, not to tell people about how to behave, but to talk about how architecture shapes behavior. So we took about 30 of our projects, analyzed them in this exhibition here, analyzed them and talked about how do people react around these projects. One of my big heroes is Jan Geel. I don't know if you know him. He's a city planner. And he has analyzed for 40 years about how people react in cities. Now we're trying to do that within buildings too, and create buildings around how people should interact and how they should move, how they should meet and talk together. And this is very much a driving factor in how we design our buildings. And then I'm talking about catalyzers. When you talk about this interaction part, what can make people interact? Staircases can. I learned that from nearly 30 years of experience here in my office, where if you walk on a staircase, you start to interact with the people next to you and start to talk to people. And staircases are, of course, fun to make because you can make them in all different kinds of shapes. So instead of putting the staircases in a separate compartment, put them in the center of the building so they become activators, or catalyzers for activity. This is how we work with them. This is in a bank. Here there's 1,000 people working in the bank. They have a cantina in the ground floor. And when they have lunch, everybody has to go down to this cantina. If they had to wait for the elevators, they would never get lunch. So they take the staircase down. And that makes them meet each other and makes them see the environment too, where they're working. And get to talk together as well. And you can use staircases as ornaments in the building, as art. Here we work together with a light artist. This is Deloitte's headquarters in Copenhagen, where this light is turning every day a little bit, and it will take 100 years before it comes back to the same kind of colors again. So every day you see something different. And symbolism is, you can use the staircases too, as well. This is the center of the UN building we did in Copenhagen. And UN is about working together, trying to prevent wars, of course, and making people talk together. So this is symbolizing a knot that is tying all the different nations together in the center of the building. And it becomes a sculpture at the same time. And these kind of spaces for, this is a project that I'm actually going to show tomorrow in Paris. If you could create spaces where staircases and lounges and work, intimate workspaces can be connected in this in big spaces, then you have another way of getting people to meet each other. And actually the driving factor for the form here is what we want to achieve. For the people inside the building. It's not so much we just form it to form it. We form it for people to meet each other and to talk together and to see how all the others in the environment are working together. So it's a little bit thinking the same way as the plants, what do you call it? Yeah, the plants I showed in the beginning. They are formed in a way so they have a purpose. And here we're trying to do the same thing as well. But all this philosophy started with this building here that we did design a little bit more than 10 years ago. It's a high school in Copenhagen, the Ørsted College building, where this is from the outside. It's a fairly straight building. It looks like a big bookshelf. This is all about knowledge. So we had a master plan that said it should follow the straight lines. But when you come inside the building, we formed it a lot. And we formed it as a big movement. And lift out all corridors, put the whole brief on all the floor plates. So every little square centimeter in this space here is used has some use. So here you can see the brief put out on the floor plates, and this is how the idea is, how the design is made. This three-dimensional open space. A boomerang shape that turns around in a spiral way. So you have an open space, five-story high, and a staircase in the middle, where everybody, all the students, has to walk up and down, and so they can see what is happening around them. I think inspiration is an important thing when you go to architect school, if you go to high school or whatever. The inspiration you get from the other students are very important, and this is actually the driving factor in this high school here. So when you come into the school, you see the cantina here in the bottom, and you can look down to a sports area, and in that sports area, you can use that as a stage as well. There's a big partition you can move away, and then you have a big stage down there. And then you can see how the staircase comes all the way up in the building. This is designed for 800 students, but they now put 1,200 students into it because it has no fixed classrooms in there. It's a big open space, sort of a we wanted to make an indoor city space inside. So here you see all the students here waiting for the dean to have a talk, and they can use this cantina down to the sports area as a big stand for what is happening around, and they can look from around here. Everything is connected to the center of the building. And this is how the staircase comes up. When you're standing where I was standing before, looking up, you'll see this staircase coming up all the way up to the top of the building. So everything is connected. You can see the whole idea in the building in that sense. So when you come up at first floor, you see this, as I said, interior cityscape with all these floor plates, maybe a little bit inspired by Positano or something. When you're in Italy, I love Positano, so that could be an inspiration, where all the houses are up along the cliffside, and you can see from one cliff to the next. And here you have, this is actually the auditoriums. You have them up here, and at the top of the auditoriums you have areas you can use for group work or for intermission as well. And this is how it looks in the evening. So a lot of daylight and a lot of nice artificial light as well, and a very visual connection between all the different floors. So when you're standing up there looking down, you're looking down to the cantina and down to the steps that goes all the way down to the sports area that you can use for different kinds of things too. So this is when you're standing at the top of the building looking out in the landscape. And you can see these tops of the auditoriums is used for, it was actually meant as intermission areas, but it's actually how the students like to work. This is students from 15 to 19. This is how they work when they are at home. So this is how they work at the school as well. They like it this way. So, and actually there's a carpet here. This is the only place where there is a carpet. So it's like being in a smaller place, a sound bubble in there, even that it is in the big place at the same time. And then they create their own teaching, learning in places around, as you do in a town. Here's a little plaza over here, and here's some students being taught by a teacher and working together. This school is about using mathematics, physics, chemistry, whatever, in another way to solve problems. So this is the philosophy of this school is more or less the same as it is in Rudolf Steiner, that you get all the information for language, mathematics, and whatever, and then you try to solve the problem. So you have to work together, or you have to work by yourself, or whatever. So this is how you work in this space here. And the students here, they get prepared for real life outside. When you go to university, like you're here, you have to be able to work by yourself, and not taught all the time what to do, as you do in a normal high school. So the idea is that they have to think by themselves, they have to be creative, and they have to learn to work together. I have had a son that went there, and he was very happy about going there. Now he wants to be a musician. I don't know what to think about that. But anyway, this is a school that teaches in music and in media as well. So it has become the most popular high school in Denmark. You can choose your own high school, and here there's five times as many students try to get in as there's space for. So they don't choose the best students. They try to make a diversity of students. So they have all different kinds of rich people, poor people, whatever, foreigners, everything in the school. So it's sort of mimicking the real society outside. That's the main idea behind it. Then they have the staircase coming up in the center, and that becomes a little bit of catwalk as well. You see this guy standing there, he's looking for the girls that are coming up. This is how you find your boyfriend, girlfriend, whatever. So, but that's part of it as well. So they walk up and down five times a day maybe. In the beginning, they complain because they're not fit, and after a while, when they get fit, it's all right. So it gives you exercise at the same time, which is quite important. Can you all hear me, by the way? Okay, good. And understand me, I hope. The staircase goes all the way up to the roof garden. And there, now we are implementing a botanical garden up there. So we're using everything in the space, outside and inside. So the roof is going to be used for botanical uses. And there's going to be an observatory up there as well. At the end, we get students out of it. And that might not be the best students in Denmark, but they are very good at working together and prepared for the real life and for university afterwards. But that building really taught us a lot about how architecture can shape behavior. And this philosophy that we used in that school, we have used in so many buildings afterwards, and has been the driving factor in everything we've done after that. And about having a philosophy about how and why you design things is very good, because it makes everything a lot easier. I think after we made that school, suddenly I realized what we were doing and why we were doing it, and made it a lot easier for us to work and to tell all the new people that come to the office what they have to get into and how they have to think about what they're designing. This is another example here that we made some years later. We just opened this building here, I think, 3 years ago. And it's about synergy. This is a town hall. Come on. This is a town hall in a small town, or a small town, there's a 60,000 inhabitant town outside Utrecht in Holland, called Nieuwerijn. And it's a town hall agricultural building, a mixed-use building, actually. On the lower floors, we have shops, and then we have exhibition areas and cultural functions, and in the top you have the municipality sitting, and the building is used as an anchor, a catalyzer between two parts of the city as well. They actually had a new building that didn't function there, so it was only 20 years old, but they pulled it down because they didn't think it was functioning, and then they went for this competition that we won. And now we have this building that's very much a building for the people of Nieuwerijn. It's not an expensive building. The Dutch are very good at doing things in a complex way, easy. Cantilever is sort of their middle name, so you have to have cantilever when you're working in Holland. So we have this cantilever here as well. And there was no question at the time, even when we were looking at the budget and trying to get into the budget, that we should leave out this cantilever. Notice that it was more about how can we solve this and still get the building within the budget. So this is how it is from the riverside. And then when you come in, you can see it's very much inspired by the high school, but it's okay to be inspired by yourself. So when you come in here, you have a staircase combining all the different floors. And the philosophy in this building here was that all the functions really wanted to be on the ground floor. They couldn't, of course, be in the ground floor. There wasn't space enough for that. We had to build it 5 stories high. And then then we made these floor plates that is turning around. So up here we have the library. And the library wanted to be visible from when you come into the building. And it is very much so. So it's an open building. This is a building for the city, from the people in the city. And they feel it's their building where they come in, because they can see the whole thing at once, and they can come everywhere in the building. There's only one elevator there in the center, because our idea is that people should use the staircase to go up, because then they can see what is happening around. And of course, disabled people can take the elevator up if they want to. But the idea is that when you take the staircase up, you can see what is happening in your building, in your cultural building, in your town hall building. That was the idea. And a lot of daylight, even though it's a very deep building, we have created a way of getting daylight into the building, into the center of the building. So, and with these white surfaces, we spread the daylight around, so you feel it's a very lit up building as well. And here at the top, we have a restaurant and a roof garden. And from there off, you have the municipality where you have the offices that are more locked in, but they have glass partitions out to the out to the restaurant. A completely different way of doing it, but with the same philosophy is this small building here that we did in a small town called Middelfart in the center of Denmark. It's only a 5,000 inhabitants town. So this was a saving bank, and they wanted a building 5,000 square meters in the center of the town, where all the townhouses are small houses and everything is low key. So to build a sort of a big building in this town was a challenge in itself. So we, when you see it from eye level, you can see that it has the same scaling as the building next to it. And we have taken some features up, like these canopies here, taking them up in the roofscape in a new way. And here you see it from a nearby bridge. You have this view of the building. You see the building is a lot bigger than all the buildings around it. But it has another scale from up here and a small scale when you are in eye level. And scaling is, I think, very important when you design architecture. It's actually half of the design too, that you have to scale it right, scale it so it fits into the context, and so it makes everything right afterwards. I have one philosophy I learned from Tom Main. He said he came to my office 25 years ago. And he said, there's no reason to build a building if you don't leave anything that's better after the building is made. And this is another philosophy too. When you build something, it has to improve the place afterwards. So that was very important with this building here, especially as well. The idea was, the bank had actually an old building at the site. And we had to pull that down because they had asbestos in the building. But they wanted us to use as much of the old construction as possible. It was a saving bank, so they want to save money, of course. And so what we did was to build on top of the old construction and make this landscape up, where all the work spaces are on top of that. And then leave a plaza on the bottom floor that the city could, the town could use as a public plaza for exhibitions, for flea markets, and whatever kind of events. They didn't have a place like that in the town, so we wanted to give something back to the town with the building as well. And then, of course, we put the roof on, and the roof has this purpose of shading for the sun and getting a view out towards the water as well. And here you have it in eye level, where you can see how it fits in from the from above. It looks a lot bigger, and then when you come down in eye level, this is a pedestrian street that's in away from the water, and here it fits in with the colors, and it fits in with the scaling. It is another kind of material. It's not a plastered building. It is a aluminum cladded building, but still it has the scaling and the colors, and you can easily use other kind of materials too, as long as you follow certain rules in scaling, I think, and in coloring of the building. And then the roofscape, that is a prefabricated roofscape. It actually only took 3 days to mount this, the whole roof here, because everything was prefabricated and it came in and they just put it on. So it was a very rational way of doing it, but leave something back to you on the inside. You get this, of course, daylight and artificial light in, at the same time, but then it becomes a sort of a pattern, an ornament in the building, as well as a functional thing. So these two things combined is, I think, very nice. That's what we try to achieve anyway all the time. And then everybody is working up here in this landscape, and they can see what the others are doing, and they can feel that like they are a team. And even that it is a fairly big space. This is 5,000 square meters, one big space more or less. We try to get the intimacy in the space at the same time, both in sound, acoustics, and in space as well. And then here we're standing at the top, and up here the director, he's sitting. He is one of the only ones that has his own office, but he goes up all these staircases and say hello to everybody every day. And this building has actually been voted the best workspace in Denmark for 4 years in a row. Not only for the building, but because they have a nice director as well, I think. But it is functioning the way that they want it to function. And then in the weekends, they can use it for this, a little concert here, or at Christmas, for Christmas tree parties and like that. So it is really used every weekend. It's occupied by different kinds of events in the building. So it becomes more than a bank building. This is a trend, I think, for bank buildings to be more than bank buildings, not only to lend money out, but to be popular too in the environment where they are acting. We work together with an artist in this building here, Ulofur Eliasson. I don't know if you know him. He's a Danish Icelandic artist. And he made these kaleidoscopes in the floor that has this grand feature. He saw the whole building as a kaleidoscope. So he made 8 different kaleidoscopes. They are 3 meters tall or deep. And this is how they are mounted down there. And then when you look down them, just the way it's 3 mirrors, and just the way it's cut in the bottom gives this fantastic picture here, 3-dimensional picture. So when you walk around, you can go and look at each of these kaleidoscopes and get another experience. Then not only the building, you see the building in another way as well, because the whole building, as you can see, is mirrored in the kaleidoscope as well. Activating. There's another way to look at buildings is if buildings always have to give something back, as I said. And some buildings are meant as catalyzers, others are meant to activate. It's more or less the same, but anyway. It's this building here is the museum in Liverpool. Again, it was about 10 years ago we were invited to design this. We had only 3 weeks to do a competition to come up with an idea, a vision for the building. And we went to Liverpool. We made this blue and white film. We've done a lot of blue and white films since. But we did it in blue and white because it was always raining in Liverpool. And in fact, we import the weather from Liverpool. So it's more or less that like we have it at home. But at the harbour side, at the pierhead, there's an old listed area where there used to be a shipyard. And Liverpool went from 1 million people down to 500,000 people. People moved away, and now they're moving back again. So they wanted to create a museum telling all the stories about Liverpool, a museum that is referring to what used to be there. There used to be a shipyard. So that's why we formed the building as we did. And then we formed the building so it could be an activator for all the people in the areas by connecting all the different parts in the area. So you can walk through the building, look down into the building, and this is where you go if you're a Liverpoolian to see what is happening in your city. And this is where the tourists come to see what is happening. In here they show, of course, the Beatles, Liverpool football. They have locomotives and they have whatever. They have 150,000 different items that they show in different kinds of exhibitions out in there. Of course, the locomotives you don't move in and out, so they are there all the time. But a lot of the small stuff they move in and out. For example, Stella McCartney stuff and like that. But it is a very interesting place here today. But this was the vision we did in the 3 weeks, and then we went over and presented it, and we were up against Liebeskin, Saadid, Tiberfield, Snøhede, and another Danish office called C.F. Møller. And we won the competition. But here we only had an idea. We didn't even know where the entrance was, but we just knew that we had this idea to make a nexus. We called it actually a nexus at that time. The nexus for Liverpool where all the different lines in the area could connect, and this could be a meeting point for Liverpool. So after working quite a bit together with a client, we came up with this model here, and we have 4 galleries, two galleries in the bottom that's where there's fixed exhibitions, and one has a little theater, and then 2 flexible galleries at the top where there's changing exhibitions. And within the first 4 months, 400,000 people came to see this exhibition. So more or less the whole population of Liverpool. And just to compare with the Beatles, they went on a tour in America, and in 1 month they had the same amount of audience. We used 4 months, and they used 1 month, but just to compare it. Anyway, I couldn't get Paul McCartney to come for the opening, but what's it called? Yoko Ono came anyway, and that was a great thing. I had dinner with her afterwards. She talked about John Lennon all the time. But anyway, this building here is not a building. It's actually more thought about as an installation growing up from the pierhead. Here you can see the landscape architect that we worked together with made this formation along the pierhead, and then it grows up and becomes our building. Because it is a listed area, we didn't think it was appropriate to build a building there. So what we wanted to do was more to do a sort of a land art, a very humble thing actually. Twist it a little bit so it doesn't prevent any views to some of the old buildings, the Three Graces they're called, at the harbour of Liverpool. So it allows for the open views to the old buildings. And we made a relief, or relief, or whatever you call it, on the facade to give it a texture that was mimicking, in a modern way, what the old building was, what we were doing there. They had this relief on the facade, but in a, of course, classical sense. Here we do it in a more modern sense. And then we had another challenge. There's a canal. There's a canal going on the... There was going a new canal they were making at the harbour front, because the water tide is going up and down 6 meters every day, so they wanted to have canal boats that could go actually underneath the building as well. So the whole building is made like a bridge construction, where you can actually sail underneath. One of the ideas we had was to make a glass floor in the middle of the building, so you could look up into the building when you're sailing along underneath. That was one we had to take out, unfortunately. And then we had this lifted up big staircases. Here again, we use a staircase, but in a different way. We use it in a way that you can use it as a stand for if Paul McCartney would come and play down here. You can sit here and watch him. He probably won't. But anyway, the idea is used very much for regattas, and people are sitting here and they're looking out on boats on the River Mersey. So it is used the way that we want it to be used. And this is from the inner harbor. And here, as you can see, it is a stone building like the other buildings. It's a little brighter than the other buildings, obviously. But it has this ship shape that refers to what used to be there, a shipyard. But this idea, again, we followed up in another building in Norway in a little town called Molde, where the building becomes more than just a building to go into, it's a building you go onto as well. Molde is a town, 20,000 inhabitants maybe, with a beautiful view like this. And in the center of the town, there was a hole. It was the worst place in the town, disconnecting the two parts. And then we were invited for a competition to do a cultural building there. It's actually very, very often when you have a big challenge, you can make something interesting. If there's no challenges, you have to find some challenges to make it interesting. But here there was a challenge. There was a cut in the center of the town, but of 10 meters. So we made the whole building as a big staircase, combining the two parts of the city. This is a building for a library and a building for jazz music. Every summer they have a jazz festival. So this staircase could be used for outdoor concerts as well, as stands for these outdoor concerts. And here we have the model from the competition, and here we have the reality. This is the summer in Molde, where the sun is up until 11, 12 o'clock. You can see they're putting up a stage. Now they're going to play jazz music in the evening. So before there was a hole here. Now you can actually be sitting up here and having the view of the fjord at the same time, so you're getting another kind of experience. And this is how it is in the evening, and this is how we like it. If you can make a building that can animate as a city, you have achieved a lot. Of course, not every day it looks like this, but it's when they have these festivals and these kind of events, they use the staircases as stands and sit there. And can have all kinds of activities around the building. Storytelling. Every architect like to make a story and like to make storytelling. Sometimes you get the possibility, and here we got the possibility when we were invited for the competition for the Blue Planet Aquarium in Copenhagen. We were working on that competition for 7 weeks, and I think the first 5 weeks we were thinking about how should we design this. We have some ideas about making a building like a big whale and whatever, but it was one day one came with this photo here, and there was the idea. Then for the next 2 weeks we worked day and night and came up with this idea, a building that is actually going to be seen from the air because it's next to the airport in Copenhagen. It's by the water, of course, but when you land in Copenhagen, you see this. You see it from the air. So the fifth facade is very important, and it's actually only from up there you can see the real idea of the building, this propeller, this whirlpool idea. The big challenge was actually to build the building, to build it within the budget as well. But we succeeded in doing. Here you can see it, how it is today, where it's cladded with aluminum. Which tested a lot of other materials, and the reason why we chose aluminum is that it actually reflects the daylight more or less the same way as water does when you see it in eye level anyway. We tested a lot of different constructions. This was a very nice one, too expensive, but as you don't see the construction anyway, there was no reason to do it this way here. So what we ended up in doing it was doing it a very simple way, like you do maybe a barn, or you do a boat with these spans here, so you can get the whole shape very easy. A steel construction like this, and then cladding it with different kind of layers, and at the end having this aluminum cladding. But the aluminum cladding was a big challenge too, and we had a more or less ordinary budget. So we used a lot of time in testing all different kinds of shapes for the aluminum cladding. Everything here becomes too customized, and every time you have to do it customized, it adds to the price of it. So at the end, we look again back to the nature, and to look at fish, how are fish cladded? They're cladded with these fish scales here, and that actually inspired us. That inspired us to clad it with shingles, all the same shape, but just a little pushed on. A little bit pushed on to the next one, so every shingle has exactly the same size. And it actually, when you look at it here, it has the resemblance of scales of a fish, and it looks very much like a fish. And this is actually how I think you can often be inspired by nature, because nature is actually very rational made. It's like God thought the same way, that you have to do it in a simple way, but it's like way. And this is how we get inspired as well. So this is how it looks in reality here. We put the building is in a little pond with water around it, so we have the feeling of going underneath the water into the building. And this is on a distance. And this is an eye level. And here it looks different, as you can see. Here it might look like a whale, actually, with a big tail here behind it. Well, I think that's all right, because it's a sea animal as well, and this is actually a natural history museum for sea animals. That's an aquarium. So you get all these different kinds of images in your head when you come there. People say, this looks like a shark mouth and whatever. I say, okay, fine. As long as you get a metaphor or an image in your head, we have achieved something, and that's important. Then we realized another thing here in the wintertime, the water in the ponds started to freeze, and when it started to freeze, they made these kind of patterns that played up to the other patterns. Of course, we haven't thought about that, but I can say we thought about that, but we didn't. But it is another little gesture from nature coming back to us in the way that we work with the building. And then the building, as I said, looked different. All depends on the weather, how it reflects the sun. This is actually, I think, a week before it opened. People not queuing up, but they were coming to see what is this all about. They were very curious. So already a week before, people were standing outside it, looking at what it was. And then, as it is called the Blue Planet Aquarium, it's obvious to take a photo in the blue hour. And then it becomes literally blue, as you can see here. And different at night time, of course, when we start to light it up. We had a light artist to work with the lighting from the outside. And he did a great job in lighting up the building. So the building becomes a different feature in the evening. And when you come into the building, we try to play with the ideas about being underwater. This was the whole idea. You should have the feeling of being underwater. So you come into the center of the building, and then we work with the same light artist, and he did this feature in the center. We have the same form in the inside of the building as we have on the outside of the building. So when you're in the big wave, you're in the Pacific Ocean as well. And there you have the big aquarium as well. And then he worked with these features on the ceiling, and there's a sound artist so that works with sound, underwater sound in there, so you can sort of mimic as good as you can and stage as good as you can of being underwater. And this is the restaurant. Here you don't see any fish, here you eat fish, and then you can look at the water from there. And then some young people trespassed and took these photos up on the roof. And I actually very much would like to make a tour over the roof, because that is actually maybe where the building is most interesting. Because here you can really see the ideas of the building, this idea of the whirlpool of waves in the sea up there. Because everything is visible here. There's no part of the roof that is not visible. And I went up there 2 weeks ago with a German film crew that was making a program about the aquarium. And see how big it is actually. It is quite huge up there. It is like being in the middle of a frozen sea, sort of. Now to something completely different. We do all different kind of buildings, and I'm showing this building here because this building here is an inspiration for another building we are making afterwards. We did this design here 5-6 years ago, I think, for a residential project in Stockholm, and finally it's slowly moving forward. It has been quite a challenge to make it moving forward. But the whole idea of this, the form has a meaning to it too, is to put a building within in the middle of two other buildings and create visual contact to the surroundings at the same time. So we formed it in these triangular shapes so we can get views out from the existing buildings, and when we get free of the existing buildings we could turn the building more around in different kinds of directions and get other kinds of views. And this building here is next to the ferries that comes in from Finland to Stockholm. So this is the first thing you meet when you come in. So we wanted to make it as a landmark building, of course, as well. So this is how it looks. You have the harbour just in front of it, and there's a new area that's going to be developed in front of it as well. And then we made a master plan for the area next to us. Next to it, it was called Valparaiso. And I don't know if you know Valparaiso, but Valparaiso has a lot of colors. So we sort of mixed Valparaiso colors with the Stockholm buildings in this master plan here. There was another competition. Unfortunately, we did not win that one. But we're still going to make these towers here fairly soon anyway. And that led to another competition that we won a little bit more than 1 year ago, 1.5 years ago. And there we were up against my good friend Tom Lane from Morphosis, and I beat him, and I'm happy about that. And then and NVRDV, Sane and Ingenhofen from Germany. This is the first time a Danish architect is doing a major thing in Sydney after my big hero Uton, that made this building that has been a symbol and an icon for a whole country. We came up with this concept here to make a gesture to his building, but in another way. I come back here. I made this little film here. In front of the building, there is the first high-rise in Australia and in Sydney, of course, as well. And that's a listed building that we had to respect. But this, by the way, is the most expensive site in Australia. So we had to get the best out of it. We had to be within this perimeter. And we twisted the building so we didn't look into the building in front of it. Then the client had been in Copenhagen and liked some of our office buildings. This is for office. So we took this kind of office building and stacked it up on top of each other and turned every part of it a little bit. This is going to be the headquarter for AMP, but there's other kind of big companies are going to move into it as well. A major idea from the city was that we should animate the streetscape around it as well. So, Jan Gehl, my other hero, he's been working a lot in Sydney, and he has a lot of ideas about how Sydney should develop, how they could get more activity into Sydney as well. So what we make here is shops, restaurants, and a market on the lower floors, connecting to the cityscape and making what is today a dead area to an active area. What we are doing is actually there's an existing high-rise at the spot today. We're using three quarters of the, or two-thirds of the existing high-rise. We're using an existing core and building around that, only adding two more elevators. And then we're doing this big marketplace, as I said, that's going to be restaurants and a lot of stuff afterwards. And we are connecting the market up into the building with big atriums. This building is 100,000 square meters and a fairly deep buildings as well. We want to create as much daylight into the building, as much view out from the building. So we're working with these kind of atriums in the high rise as well. So it's sort of a vertical village we're doing here by stacking all these buildings on top of each other. Every building has its own little atrium, and that increases the view out. You get a better view, as you can see, up and down. And you can get this kind of interaction, activity sharing space as we like. So this is the ideas that we have now been working with for more than 1 year. We just got the design application approved, so we are now going ahead doing this building here, which is marvelous. And as you can see, when you are standing in a building with a big atrium, you get a better view down than you would if you just had a floor plate that comes all the way out to the facade. So when you get out of the elevators, normally in a high-rise, you get into a corridor and you go into an office space. But here you actually, when you come out of the elevator, straight away get a view out. Here you have the skyline of Sydney. You can see the building there. The existing conditions are like this. There is this high-rise at the site today. What we're doing is we're demolishing a third of the old high-rise, keeping the old core, and then we're adding twice as many square meters to the building around it. So we are upsetting another an old high-rise. It's a very sustainable way of doing it. Instead of pulling the whole high-rise down, we are using as much as we can of the old one. And then we're getting a completely new building that has another kind of landmark feature to it. As I said, we are stacking these kind of office spaces on top of each other, turning them around so we get a view that doesn't look straight into the building in front of it. Actually, now there's somebody that wants to move in there, and we are just showing with the renderings how the views will be. This will be a view to the bridge this way here, and views up here will be down to the upper house, of course. And then we have the roof gardens higher up in the building between every section. So the building is saluting a little bit to Richard's building, and this is how you meet it when you just come around the corner into the streetscape, and you see this quite dramatic feature, even that it is buildable and it's within an economy and everything. It looks a lot more dramatic than it actually is, but it is a thing that you notice when you come to the city. As I said, the atriums are important for the views up and down and for the interaction inside the building. And at the top there will be some restaurants, cafes, and there will be a roof garden up there as well. We worked a lot with the daylight, and we worked a lot with the sustainable features in the building, how we shape the facade, so the facade is not just a glass facade, but it performs well with the sunshading. So we made this relief in the facade. that is actually quite simple, but here you can see it. This is actually the angle the sun is in. Here he's standing on the ground floor looking up, but it's actually in the angle that the sun is in. Sydney is quite much to the south in the summertime, so you can see the sun doesn't hit the glass. And here you can see how much it prevents the sun heat to come into the building. It prevents it by 30.4%. So so we get a building that is performing well under, anyway, under Sydney Australian conditions. We developed the podium a lot more. The city wanted it more divided up and not so horizontal. So now the cityscape is sort of a horizontal village, and the high rise is a vertical village. The site is a site that goes 14 meters up, so we connect in a lot of different levels. So when you come from the street up here, you can go straight into this level here, and then you can go down into the building as well. So this streetscape here on the top of the podium is very important, and it's going to be an area for different kinds of events as well. A straight move to something else that we actually won at the same time. The Olympic Unity House for the Olympic Games headquarters in Lausanne. We won that just before summer last year as well. Here the president wanted something that could show movement. IOC is a movement, sports is a movement, and something that is transparent. Have all this discussion with FIFA. He wanted IOC to be a transparent organization, so that we had to show in the building. So we've tried to find some inspiration to movement, and the inspiration is here. Here you can see the movement in the snowboarders here, if you make this time-lapse photos. And this was actually a big inspiration to how we work with the facade and the form of the building. And as I said, we do a lot of these test models. So here are some of the models that we did for testing before we came to the result. And even after we came to the result, we started working on it more and more and more to make the facade perform as good as possible and the shape perform towards happening on the inside. We're going to be on the roofscape and as well, so everything has to be developed more and more. The facade, as I said, is a very transparent facade. In the same way, we wanted it to be sustainable in the way that not to let too much sun heat into the building. So we worked with this skeleton on the outside, and it's actually a structure that is keeping the building up, so we don't need any columns behind this. So it is a bearing facade, and at the same time it's performing, so it's sun shading. From the competition, the facade was very transparent, and here you can actually see a little bit about what we were inspired by as well, this muscle here and how we work with the shape of the building. But then we started working with the facade more and more with this structure, and to make it perform as well, and of course to make it nice at the same time. And we started checking how much sun heat comes in if we do this and that as well, while we were designing. So the whole thing is controlled all the way through, and the design is, of course, a little bit inspired by this here too, but this design is actually trying to perform as good as it can with the whole outside structure, and that becomes the idea of the form as well. The inside of the building is directly referring to IOC and to Olympic Games, with the five rings as five staircases come up into the building. So this is how we did it from the competition, and then we started working a little bit more with it. We had another idea. When you come in, we have this big world map and these rings, again the five rings that you can move around, with a monitor inside every ring, so you can see where the Olympic Games has been, and you can see a little film about what happened in the different countries while you're in there. And then we started working with doing a little bit more sporty inside too. They didn't really go for that, but that was actually fun. It's funny how the whole environment, the whole idea can change a lot just with colors and how you make it. They're a little bit more conservative when it comes to that. So we tested a lot of different things, and I think that's important to do. And this is in the winter time. Now I just going to show something completely different. We won a competition not long ago for this organization here. I'm not saying the name, you can see it. And of course, when you have to do something for this company, you have to take up what this is all about. It's about breaks. So the whole building is about breaks and play and interaction, of course, too. And for the people that works in the organization to get inspired by each other and working together and having fun. And it's in Billund. It's a small town in Denmark. So it's everything is small scale. So what we did was to scale it down to create it around four themes: garden, water, dunes, and forest, to create this kind of environments in between the workspaces, so they can sit and workshop with the feet and sand in the dunes, or they can sit on the leaves in the forest, or they can sit in the garden, or they can sit in the boat in the water. That was actually some of the ideas we had about this working environment, and getting inspired by seeing what all the others are doing too as well. Doing a Lego three-dimensional thing. I think we all have played with Lego when we were kids. I did definitely a lot. So Lego has had a great importance for me too. So to do this kind of thing has been really fun. It's been difficult too, but it's been really fun. So it's it looks quite similar. It took us a long time to come to this. So, but it's very similar with these breaks and this roofscape that is moving up and down and around. Both in the ground floor and in the ceiling and in the furniture, in everything, trying to do it up in all the ways that you can think about here too. They have this problem, they are out in nowhere, so it's quite hard for them to get international people to come and work for them. Here they can get another kind of environment is the idea. So it should be an exciting place to come to. That was the idea, and to have small spaces, big spaces. I think diversity is a key word too when you make architecture, not to make it just one scale and everything, but to make it exciting. And visual contact again is very, very important. So when you come to it, of course you have your big man there, Lego man. And everything is scaled. There's a villa area just on the other side, and actually the big man who has the whole company, it's a family-owned company, he lives just on the other side, and he wants to look at something nice and not too big. Even if this is big, this is more than 50,000 square meters. So I think one of the challenges is again the scaling, try to do it as a small scale project. Then again to something completely different. And this is residential. This is in the town I come from, Aarhus. We did this competition here with UN Studio 10 years ago and won it, and then was going to start up and everything, and then the developer went bankrupt. We ran into the crisis. Then we got a new developer. They bought everything up for a cheaper price, and then we started up doing it. And we have now done this part here. It is residential, but it's residential both with condominiums and with social housing as well. So it's a mix. The idea is to mix people, not to make it as a ghetto for rich people, but make it a mix for all kinds of different people, as we really like to do it. It is in an old container harbor. It's a regained land. So the whole thing is formed out like waves. This is the inspiration, both the way that the buildings are formed and, of course, the facade. Here's the north side of the promenade. And because of this way that we form it, we can get the sunlight to come to the north side and make it attractive. If it was only one big block here, this would be in the dark all the time, especially in the wintertime. So I think just to take this idea up, we got a lot of improvement out of it. We did a lot of models in this one here as well, and this is the first part here being finished with a facade in fiber concrete, and it was sold out before it was built, everything. So now we are ready for the next part, and that has developed a lot. We couldn't make the big tower that was 150 meters. because of foundation reasons. So we redeveloped the whole thing to a smaller tower. It's still 110 meters, so it's fairly big as well. And made another kind of cluster idea. Put the parking up. The first part here, the parking is down into the water, and that's a quite expensive way to do it. So we lifted the parking up in two floors here in the center of a plaza up here. So we could save some money in that way. You saw the other buildings there here, so the scaling is going to be bigger at the end. It's called Lighthouse, and it's going to be a lighthouse in Aarhus. This is we're getting close to the end now. We're going back to GXN. I would say 3XN stands for three times Nielsen. My name is Nielsen. The other two Nielsens are not my brothers. Some think they are. Nielsen is the most common name in Denmark, so we just took it up when we started the office to make it as a little bit of a joke, like Smith, Smith and Smith. We call it Nielsen, Nielsen and Nielsen. After a while, it becomes three times Nielsen, and now it's 3XN. Because when we started working in the Liverpool Museum, they always called us 3XN, so that became the name. And GXN is standing for green, and green research is led by this guy, Kasper, with a hat. He always walk around with his hat on for some reason. He's doing all this. He's a fantastic guy that has all these ideas, a little bit a nerd, and you have to be that to work in that kind of field to take the challenges up in a good way, to make a problem into an advantage, to turn things around. When we were doing this building here on the harbourfront of Copenhagen, the client asked us to do a sustainable building, and to this form here that we came out with, to do a form, this folded form here, we had the problems in doing the form in a traditional way. We could do it with steel and with concrete, but we became too expensive and a lot heavier. So what we did was to use foam and glass fiber as a construction, and then clad the building with travertine. So the facade here is self-shading, so it allows it. The building will use 10% less energy just because of the shape of the facade. And here we have the elements. It's two elements that we put on top of each other. And the elements are formed out with this foam. This is actually how you make a windmill wing. In Denmark, we have the biggest windmill wing industry in the world. And so we're trying to learn from one industry to another. And I think it's interesting, actually. I would like to work together, for example, with car manufacturers, too, because I think we could learn a lot from car factories in Torino, or wherever, in the building industry as well. That could be fun to do, and that's probably going to be the future as well. So this is how the building is made. You can see here, from the south, you can see no windows. The north, the windows are open out towards the canal. So this is a law firm, so every lawyer can have his own little bay window, and he doesn't need any shading for the sun, because of you. And we are working on this project, Green School of Stockholm, where they're teaching green technologies down here. It's a high school, actually. And then they have the dormitories up here, so that's where they live. And we're trying to test everything possible green in this building here. Of course, the green facades that we have developed with local species, living machine where we are cleaning all the gray water and everything and reusing it. And then urban farming. In here in the building. So if you're a vegetarian, you never have to leave the building. You can get all the food and everything in there as well. So we realized that we can grow, for example, strawberries harvest them eight times a year, grapes only once. So you can be sitting under the strawberries instead of under the grapes and eat them from time to time. So this is a dormitory where you look out to the farming, and this is just one experiment we doing together with the algae facades. The more sun, the more algae, and then you can harvest the algae in the nighttime and use it for fertilizing or whatever, a lot of different things. And then we are looking into materials. This is a structure we made for an exhibition at Louisiana in Copenhagen, biocomposite material, and we formed it as a Möbius form here, never ending, and implemented all different kinds of features on it, solar panels up here and whatever, to show that it could do a lot of different things. But the real thing was that we made it out of cork, flex fiber, soy, and corn. So it, we developed a new material, and we went to Paris to a big fair in Paris, and we were awarded the best composite material of the year, up against Lamborghini and Boeing and other companies, as the only architect firm. Then we developed another material here a year ago, from flex fiber. You can use flex fiber for cloth, of course. You know that for bags. But you can actually form it together with other biomaterials, so you can make a plate material that has the same function as aluminum. And we did this material, and again, we got another award from that. Thank you.